Keila Trinae, Cameron David, DJ Reed, Miss Ro-Ro, Dontrell Detroit, Key 77. This is U Nation Radio.
Monday night, love session. Check us out, Generation. Slow jams, conversation. Late night stimulation. Call in, love session. Love session.
Monday night.
Shush. Good evening. U Nation Radio family. This is your girl, Akilah Trinae, and you are tuned in to Monday Night Love Session. Thank you, Chris. Today is March 23rd, 2015, and we have an awesome show in store for you. We have a special guest, Kelvin Truitt, who's going to grace our studio and share some really, really good information for us today with our topic, fatherhood, finance, and faith. In addition to that, we also have our edition of the Artist Spotlight with Miss Ash Rogue. So just stay tuned. And without any further ado, I'm going to kick it to my left. You're probably going to be like, who is that? So I'm going to let him introduce himself. We have a couple of people who are out today. I guess it's some kind of bug or something going around. I don't know. So keep him in prayer. DJ Ree is out, not feeling well. So hold him up. Continue to hold his wife up. His son, I believe, is celebrating a birthday, if not today, tomorrow, or yesterday. But happy birthday to little Xavier. And and Cam not feeling well. Keep him up as well. And Detroit is on his way. Oh, he's somewhere. He's in the building somewhere. We might see his lovely face at some point. But to the left.
Hey, what's going on? This is Nels. I'm filling in. We're going to have a crazy show. Good show. Great topics. But we're going to give a shout out to our sponsors here. Pitbull energy drink. It definitely is good. We got Artistic Web. Thank
Spider
you.
Lope.
Spider.
My daddy. Shout out.
And Black Line. Thank you for all of it.
We got to say Black Line.
Entertainment.
Can you zoom in on that?
Oh, wait.
What was that?
Black Line.
Representer.
Sort of, in a way.
Yeah. So, I'm going to kick it over to Key 77. I didn't know.
You don't know my name. He don't know my name because he fresh on the mic. It is I, Key 77. Good evening. I am here to say hello and to give out a shout out to let you know that you can follow us on Facebook at U Nation Radio. You can follow us on Twitter at U Nation _radio. Instagram, U Nation Radio. YouTube, U Nation Radio TV. And guess what? We got a GoFundMe, so please, GoFundMe. Not me personally.
U Nation Radio.
At GoFundMe, U Nation. Okay. And then guess who's back in the mic? In the studio. I was to say on mic. See,
I got you.
Looking all bright.
I got you.
I'm going to pass it on over to Detroit.
Looking like a green M&M.
Good evening.
A Skittle. It looks like a Skittle.
I'm glad I could brighten up somebody's day. Been a long day. Nonetheless, glad to be here. But if you want to give us a call and join in, the number is 323-965-1600. Again, that is 323-965-1600. We have a great show on tap today. We are talking about father, faith, and finances. The three F's. Normally, my grandma said don't ever get F's. Three F's at that because you're failing royally. But these are good three F's that we need to talk about and that are vital to all of our lives and relationships. So Can't wait for you guys to join in with us and get this together started.
Thank you so much.
How late am I?
Not too late. I do want to say right this. I do want to say this, you guys, because over the weekend, my parents celebrated 35 years of marriage.
That's a long time.
Matrimony. Yes, it is. Shout out to them. So what I want to do is, this is a quick little, hey, tribute parents. I know you're watching out there, you know. They had a unique situation. You know, they got, Chris, are you ready? Phones is ringing and all of that. I want to make sure I want to do it at the same time. See, I got to say it again. So shout out to my parents who celebrated 35 years of holy matrimony. They first got married at a courthouse. And so I'm going to show you a picture. Yeah, that's them at the courthouse. Y'all probably didn't know I was going to show that picture, y'all. And then a year later, they actually had a wedding. And so, you know, they just love getting married. So that's how you know the love is real. So then in 2010, they renewed their vows at 30 years and had another wedding.
Wow, three marriages.
Right.
Without divorce, so, that's impressive.
Without, exactly.
You got married three times? Yeah. Without divorce.
Exactly.
Man, some of us can't even be with a man for a minute. True, let alone 35 years.
Who are you talking about?
I'm just saying.
But along the same lines of marriage and the beauty of marriage, we had a special couple on our show, Virginie and Aaron White, or I should say Aaron and Virginie White. And they, over the weekend as well, brought in their little baby girl
into the world.
Yes.
Congratulations.
So congratulations to them. We love you here at U Nation Radio, so you guys have to come back and tell us all about that experience.
Man.
And that new new life. New life for
the
baby.
We gotta put they drop on tonight.
Yeah, we gotta make sure that is definitely play. But you know what? We're not even gonna prolong this beginning part of the show. I'm gonna let Detroit do what Detroit does. So Detroit, do it.
What it do?
What it do?
We're about to get out of here to our first commercial break and listen to some Eddie Murphy. Ooh, la la. I'm just playing. DJ Chris, cue us up. Yeah.
Are you bringing me back? Did nobody hear you count down? We are back.
I'm on your side.
We are back. U Nation Radio, Monday Night Love Sessions. Again, I'm your girl, Akilah Trene. And we are going to get into it. I am like super duper duper excited about our guest today. Because I've known this young man for at least 10 years. It's been at least 10 years, probably longer. I'm not going to look at you because I'm introducing you. But very humble young man. He is a loving husband, a father, an entrepreneur, a lover of Jesus. What else can I say? I think he sings a little bit. He produces the wonderful show, My First Fridays. He's going to tell you more about that. He has his own clothing line, and I'm wearing one of the shirts that, you know, his store sells. It is a men's line, but I'm going to let him tell you all more about that. But U Nation Radio family, Monday Night Love Sessions, please help me welcome to our show, Mr. Kelvin Truen.
Welcome.
What up, everybody?
You on, bro?
This is great.
This is great.
Yeah, I'm so proud of you, man. This is awesome.
I'm more so proud of you.
So what's up, U Nation?
What up?
Same old same, man. What's going on?
Man, it's good to see you, man. East Coast in the building.
So, Kelvin, I mean, that was my intro of you, but like, just, you know, tell us about you so that everybody can get to know who you are. I mean, before we jump into the topic.
For sure. That definitely reminds me of that question in, what was it, Why Did I Get Married? Christmas or something? Oh, no. Best Man Holiday.
Uh-huh.
You know, and I guess it will be summed up in tonight's topic, you know, family, finances, and faith is all a part of who I am. In short, I feel like I'm called to this earth to impact the lives of people, and whatever platform I get to do that in, I want to do it. So loving life, loving people, loving each other, I think we all gonna make this world a better place. So the last 10 years of knowing you, or at least 10 years, whether it's music, faith, whether it's friends or whatever it is, I definitely just feel blessed to be alive at this time. I wouldn't want to be alive no other time than now. So thank you for having me.
Selma is now. But that's awesome. That's really awesome. I'm really, really glad that you are here. And I just kind of want to jump into it because I know that everything that you represent will come forth and come out through our topic. And the first subtopic that we want to talk about is fatherhood, because you are a father. And I'm sure you can give us a little more in just a moment. But I was looking online, and just to preference with our host, I want to share the information first, and then after I share the information, then we can kind of discuss and talk about it. So, Detroit, get your notebook and your pen ready to start, because I know you're going to be like, oh, I want to say, but you're not going to be able to say just right away. You know, again, if you want to join our conversation, if you have questions for our guests, you can dial the number 323-965-1600. So, let's just jump into it. So, I was looking online, and I found on the Huffington Post, I believe it was the Black Voices section, this article is called Five Lies We Should Stop Telling About Black Fatherhood. This was published last year around Father's Day, so I think that was kind of the theme at the time. But it says that we assume that African-American men aren't part of that conversation when we discuss fatherhood, largely because a number of studies and reports have repeatedly told us that Black fathers are overwhelmingly absent from their children's lives. However, while these numbers are nothing to ignore, they contribute to a damaging narrative about Black men and negate the achievements of the number of Black men who play an active role in their children's lives. So I'm just gonna go through the five lies, and then we can kind of talk about it. The first one: Black fathers aren't involved in their children's lives. It says, recent data published by the Center of Disease Control revealed that African-American fathers spend more time in their children's day-to-day lives than dads from other racial groups, defying stereotypes about black fatherhood. The Pew Research Center has also found similar evidence that black dads don't differ from white dads in any significant way, and that there isn't the expected disparity found in so many other reports. Another statistic says that 67% of black dads who don't live with their kids see them at least once, compared to 59% of white dads and just 32% of Hispanic dads. Next lie. The increasing number of single-parent homes is exclusively a black problem. The number of single-parent American households has tripled in number since 1960, and while an overwhelmingly majority of these households are likely to be led by black or Hispanic women, the number of black single-father households is also on the rise. So basically, with that one, it's basically saying that fathers are also taking the role of raising their children separate from the mothers, you know, because mainly people think like only the moms are taking the children in. The next lie, the number of unwed mothers is a statement on morality in the black community. I just wanted to share this little piece under that. But while the number of unmarried black women has substantially grown, the actual birth rate measured by births per 1,000 for black women is at the lowest point that it's ever been documented. So while a large number of black women are choosing not to marry, many of those women are also choosing not to bring kids into the world. The last two, men who didn't have fathers won't make good fathers. Children in absent father homes are almost four times more likely to be poor, and being raised without a father raises the risk of teen pregnancy. Marrying with less than a high school degree and forming a marriage where both parents have less than a high school degree. However, men who didn't grow up with their fathers are not incapable of being good fathers themselves. And the last lie, black fathers are an anomaly. Black fathers do exist, a message that entrepreneur William K. Middlebrooks hopes to spread with his book, Dare to Be Extraordinary, a collection of positive life lessons from African-American fathers. The book recognizes the wisdom and teachings of African-American fathers passed down to sons and daughters. So those are the five lies. I'm going to let you guys chime in.
Yeah, well, first and foremost, I'm glad that they are all lies. I interface with a lot of men, black men, all men, you know, who have taken the great honor of being a father. I know in my life, being a dad, being a father is one of the most profound experiences one would ever be able to experience in this lifetime. I feel like it's a part of our legacy when you have kids. I remember my first son was born, and it literally was a supernatural experience. It brought my wife and I closer together, just to be able to recognize that our love for each other created this new life, you know, and it gives you a purpose and awakening that other things, money can't do that, you know. It's only Absolutely. through giving life that we're able to do that. So, you know, I'm glad that we read some lies about it,
right.
You know what I mean? And get that out the way so we can start telling the truth about, you know, just the heritage of fatherhood that we get to live out. So,
because it's always negative, and I found that very interesting even when I was going through the article, because I never even really thought about it from that perspective. Because we always talk about, you know, the media says this, or black men are not in the home, or, you know, but not really taken into account. And I have another article where I'll share more concrete information about the fathers who are not in the home, but how they're still active in their children's lives, you know, because sometimes we don't give that enough credit either.
Yeah, and I think we should also highlight, you know, I mean, a lot of fathers, man, aren't biologically, you know, the father of kids, but there's coaches, pastors, uncles, you know, neighbors and stuff that have fulfilled the role of a father, man, in a lot of black neighborhoods. A lot of our subculture is built on community, you know what I mean? And And so I just take my hat off to everybody that's taking a child in, taking a child out to dinner, showing them something that they may not have seen because of the fatherless epidemic, you know. But,
right,
you know, we've been here for centuries, and I'm one to really celebrate the fact that a lot of men are getting it done out there.
Would you have some encouraging words to a male that's upcoming to be a father, like that's brand new to it, that's first time and just out of his mind? What can you say to that person?
Oh, for sure. For sure I got some words for him. The very first thing is get ready for the time of your life, and by no circumstances do you miss the delivery of your baby. Like,
please don't.
You know, you gotta be there. You gotta be there. Once you see that, it will change you as a man. My second piece of advice is if you married, if you're living with your child's mom, and hopefully that's the situation, you need to wake up when she wake up. You can't do nothing. Woo! So she gonna let you go to sleep, you know what I mean? But I'm giving you free advice. If you just get up and say, you know, babe, I'm what you need. And for those of us fathers that got kids, you know you can't do nothing, but at least provide that moral support to your lady, letting her know she not in there alone, even if she breastfeeding or what have you. You know, it don't take much to change a diaper or to bring the baby from the crib to their mom, you know. So just be there and wake up every time she wake up, and build that legacy together. You know, let the baby throw up on you, you know. And skin to skin. I'm getting too technical. Yo, women are able to pass on these nutrients through breastfeeding, but fathers, you need to, you know, get shirtless as well and have that skin to skin contact with your baby, because it creates a bond like nothing else in the world. You know what I'm saying? That flesh to flesh contact
that's what's up.
Father can have with their children, it's beautiful. I got in shape for my first baby. I gained some pregnancy weight for my second baby. Hey, but I was walking around, you know what I mean, belly and all. Like, I'm getting my skin to skin in with my with my children. So,
well, that's awesome.
That's dope.
Because I know someone and they're nervous on becoming a father, you know, going through the stages of the pregnancy. Mm-hmm. How can that person, you know, help the woman out with the pregnancy, though?
Awesome. I like to think that both parents have a labor involved. Obviously, the mom's labor is spent during the delivery, but a father's labor starts way before that, you know. And I think that the labor pains, the adjusting to having a father, I mean, to having a child, it really affects the dad as well. So for that young man that's out there about to have, you know, your first kid, you just got to go through a father's labor. You know, get up and go to work. If you need to do some push-ups, do something you never done before to get used to it, so that, you know, your world ain't rocked when this baby gets here, you know. But it's definitely a good thing. Don't be scared. You know, just know that God gonna give you the strength to do what you're supposed to do, and it's something that nobody else could create but you. So you're the man of the hour, so step up. Step up, you know.
I just wanted to share a few more statistics. It says Black fathers who live with their children are just as involved as other dads who live with their kids, or more so. For instance, among fathers who live with young children, 70% of Black dads said that they bathed, diapered, and dressed those kids every day, compared with 60% of white fathers and 45% of Latino fathers, according to a report released by the National Center of Health Statistics. Nearly 35% of Black fathers who lived with their young children said that they read to them daily, compared to 30% of white dads and 22% of Latino dads. Because, you know, that also goes against, you know, Black families aren't being read to or anything like that. So I thought that was nice to know. And basically for that survey, they surveyed about 3,900 fathers between 2006 and 2010 to get that data.
There's nothing in here you want me to dispel, right? Because you seem like you're just spitting out all the good stuff.
Because you're a single, you're a father.
No, I'm just saying, like,
I was waiting for you to chime in. I'm like, we're talking about fatherhood. I know you're a daddy. Like, you love to talk. I was waiting for you to talk.
No, I was just saying, but I'm like you'll say something, all this good stuff, and been like, so now what? Well, I concur.
No, see, See, just that right there, you make it seem like I never say good stuff. And I do. All the time.
You do, about women. And about fathers, so I'm not playing with you.
Yeah, I'm going to let you let that one slide. And hope that you have something good to say right now.
I missed you. I agree with that as well. I always read to my son. But as me and you had conversations all the time, and these things would always come up, and I would always tell you, I'm like, you know what? Not the people that I know. And you would always be like, your favorite line is, who are these men? And I would tell you, like, to me, a lot of that stuff is generational, that kind of past. You know, in the men that I know that in my age bracket, I don't know how old you are. Young,
33.
Damn, see, he about there.
he's older than you.
Okay, I'm saying.
He's still in his age bracket.
I deserve that. So, but yeah, people in our age bracket, like, they seem more ready and prepared, if nothing else, willing to embark upon this journey of fatherhood and take it personal. Just the men that I know, just either they were either with me growing up playing hooping without a dad, or had one and vowed to be just like their dad. You know, like I said, I grew up around a lot of good, decent men, not in my home, but around me. And so I either wanted to be like them or be the exact opposite of what I didn't have at home. And that's kind of where it is. And my group of friends, either they have kids and they take care of them and they're around them, or the ones that don't have God kids or went and adopted a kid of some sort and they're taking care of them. Like, one of my best friends, Mim, like, he is like the greatest dad to not be an actual dad. Like, he that little girl of his, like, she doesn't want for anything. Like, he's just amazing with her. And I'd be like, wow, I envy you. Like, you're awesome. Like, that's not even yours. You know, you've been there since day one, you know. And that little girl calls you daddy. You know, like, she cries when she don't see you.
Wow.
You know, like, that's love. As far as the skin to skin, I feel you. But when but even before that, oh my God, when it comes to getting up for a child. Now, for me, I was very ill when my son was born. So all I knew, my son, they was like, you know what, your son is coming, get here. So I left UCLA Hospital in Santa Monica to get to Downey in Norwalk to see the birth of my son. So I held him for about 5 minutes before I ended up going back into the hospital. Wow. Back at UCLA. Wow. So I missed the first 2 months of being at home with my son. But when I got out the hospital, the mother of my child, she asked the doctor, she said, will he be okay to help with the child? She was like, yeah, you know, as long as he takes his meds, he's fine and cool. So when I came home and I went to sleep that night and that baby cried that morning, she didn't budge and was like, your turn. Mind you, she slept like a baby, you know, and so I'm thinking to myself, like, so she just ain't gonna get up and do anything. She's like, no, figure it out. And I was like, cool. I would say after about 20 minutes, you know, of like, look, can you please fix it? It's broke. Like, it just won't stop. You feel me? So it just broke. It just won't stop. And you get better as it goes on, but it was the most, oh my God. I just thought to me, I would lay in the bed during the day. I mean, during the day, like, she did this crap for 2 months.
2 months.
2 months. And I wasn't here. I was like, I don't know what they make women of, but I'm definitely not made of that stuff. You know what I mean?
And fatherhood, for me, it gave me a whole new respect for women. Period.
This is how much it changed my perspective on women and how mad it made me at men. I know plenty of dudes that would have kids and just go about their business.
Yeah.
Didn't that really mean much to me? You know, whatever. After that 2 months, I knew a dude who had kids that had another kid and he hadn't took care near one of them. Oh, I gave him a piece of my mind.
Yes, you,
like,
should.
Nigga, what the? Yeah. Is you? You have no. He like, is you a? I'm like, no, I'm not a woman, but you have no clue. He was like, I think you and your feelings. I am. You feel me? Because you don't understand what's going on. And he was like, you know what? I really don't want to hear this right now. But you need to hear it. You know? And granted, circumstances prevent you from doing certain things, and we make bad decisions and who we sleep with. But when you have that child, and that child is their child, and asks to be there, and you know what? He didn't start taking care of his kids until he experienced his last child's birth.
Wow.
And that made him go back. And now he's got a great job. He takes care of all his kids. But it wasn't until he seen that child born.
It's a must.
Oh, so he wasn't there for the other times, but the last time
he wasn't there for any of it. And I tell women that all the time. You have to make these men be accountable in a sense of putting their kid in front of them. That's fine. He can't do it. You tell him no. You feel me? If whatever he can't have, that's fine. I would say, hey, you know what? If he can't have it, don't trip, little lady. Make him tell that child no. It'll kill you, like, cause it's like, you know, cause I will not go in the store with my son if I don't have enough money to give him whatever he points at. Cause telling him no, just don't add up to me. And now he wants to pay for it. Like, so now I can't even give the money to the man. It's like, no, daddy, give me the money. You know what I mean? And then now he's like, he's learning like with this debit card thing. So he's like, he don't understand it cause it's not actually paper. So the dude's trying to take it and he's just like, no, I don't understand it.
You got your son paying with debit cards?
But it's definitely a learning and chilling experience that you just won't forget. But in to your other the latter part of the question, I really personally, me and him have this discussion. I'm not sure there's too much you can do to prepare for fatherhood. I do like the push-ups because holding that baby from around the house like that. 5 pounds, whatever they weigh, turn into 20, and then by the hour in, they like 45-pound dumbbells. You like, God, like I only got two arms. Like, where else I'm gonna hold this thing? Like, that's how I just started doing push-ups and held my baby on my back.
It changed for me. The I recently just had a son back in December. He was born on my birthday, so that was an instant bond.
Yeah.
Best feeling in the world.
Oh man.
But
my son shared Kobe's birthday.
When my wife got pregnant the first time, I actually got a personal trainer. And I was like, because I didn't want to be that dad that's sitting next to the bed while she's going through the worst pain of her life. And I haven't been in that space in a while. Mm-hmm. So I went to the gym, you know, had my little action figure body on point or whatever. So I would tell her stuff that the trainer would tell me, come on, push, do it, you know, that type of stuff. And we did the class and everything like that. And unfortunately, it resulted in an emergency C-section.
Monster.
But, you know, during the time that she labored, I felt equipped with something because I brought my flesh under, like, control.
Can I ask you a question?
I love questions.
How did you take the birth of your son, like, while she's sitting there in pain? That killed. I used to be in the hospital saying, like, you know what? Why me, Lord? I don't want to be in the hospital with somebody to share this pain. When I saw her in labor, I'm like, why her, Lord? She's so small. Yeah. Why are you doing this to her? What did I do? Like, I couldn't take it. Like, I don't ever want to see that again.
Yeah. No, how did I take it? I still deal with it today. I still have
traumatized.
Have flashbacks. And I had two totally extreme experiences. The first time, I literally, if I could have gotten to bed and delivered the child, I would have been the first man to ever do it, but I would have done it.
I hear you.
Done it. The second time, we were just so focused and on one accord, you know, that it was like clockwork. You know, we got up, we had breakfast, we had prayer, we went to the hospital, we had the baby, we chilled. She sang happy birthday, you know, told me happy birthday, that type of thing. Because, you know,
when is your birthday, by the way?
On the 4th day of December. So a few months ago. It's something that it's something you can't shake. And then during the C-section, you know, they did that emergency procedure because my son was having difficulty, and then my wife was having difficulty at the same time. So you see these monitors, you know, beeping.
That monitor is the worst. It's the evil.
So you hear your baby's heart rate, you know, drop and declining, and then you hear your wife's heart rate.
It's the most inconsistent thing there.
And childbirth is the closest a woman will ever get to death. Mm-hmm. You know, so you standing there, lightweight, feeling like it's your fault.
There's nothing you can do.
You know? And so to answer the question, you know, how did I feel? How did I take it? There's
help.
There's literally nothing I can just.
It's the worst. It's the scariest feeling.
It's the scariest feeling, and it makes you feel responsible. I know it awakens something.
What
in
about
me.
When they took her to the other room? Like, wait, are you.
Bro.
Wait, where the
bro?
Where is she?
We no longer in the room. No,
where is she going?
Yeah. So
where is she going?
If y'all don't know, let me invite you into the experience. They take the baby out. It's literally about 40 seconds to 2 minutes, right? They clean the baby up, wrap it in a little burrito, right? Little baby burrito. They bring it up to the mom's face. Mom looks at the baby. And mind you, this is during a cesarean, right? So everything that's on the inside of her body is now on top of the stomach, right? Then they don't tell you anything because this is a major operation, you know what I mean?
Right.
And, you know, in the case of my first baby, he was having trouble. So he has his own set of doctors. They put him in a little plastic and left. They have one obligation, and that's to keep your child alive. So they don't need to explain. Right. They don't need to do any of that. And so you're just wondering, who do I stay with? My wife is laid here on the operating table, and they just took this new life that I'm responsible for into a mystery room. What do I do? And that shows you where your loyalty lies. And for me, I'm a covenant keeper. So I'm like, hey, it's me and her first. So I stayed, and then had to find the strength.
You know the order.
I want my kid. I'm sorry.
Order.
I want my son. I left. You mean, where's
Shady.
He? No, I just had a feeling she was gonna be all right. But see, the mother of my child wasn't in peril how his was. It was kind of brought on by hers. Like, she wanted to alleviate the pain, so she kept standing up, walking.
Oh.
And they told her, they said, sit. Yo. And she kept standing up, walking, and soon tied around his neck, heart rate dropped, gotta get him out of it.
Gotcha.
And then he wouldn't cry. They were like, he needs to cry.
Yeah.
And she's like, she said, touch him. Maybe he'll cry. She turned her back for a split second. I'm sorry.
And he knocked down his camera.
Sorry. Yeah. I hit him that hard. But I was like, oh.
He's about to go to jail right after this.
Right, abuse.
I was sitting there nervous because I'm like,
yeah.
It's great.
He cried then, didn't he?
I'm so glad I've learned so much in this short moment about fatherhood. Yes, we are.
Can I have a question first before we go on commercial?
Well,
then?
No, because then he's going to have to answer. We're going
Darn
to a
it.
New thing. You can ask him off the air, you know, but our listening audience won't be able to hear.
You can ask him now, and then he can answer when we come back.
I know.
No, we're going to be moving to something new.
No, that's why.
You got to give me
some closing.
Go ahead.
Dontrell.
Oh. Ask your question.
It's Dontrell a question. Okay, because I know Calvin, he's married.
Gotcha.
So you was not married when you found out that your, you know, girlfriend was pregnant. How did that reaction make you feel when you found out she was pregnant?
Well, we were engaged, so it was the happiest thing in life to me because I had already been shot, and because I was on, because of my condition, they said I might not be able to have kids. So when I was laying there on the grass, and I went for the ambulance to get me, all I could think of is I'm the only hunter in my family. I don't know my father. And everybody else is either a pitchfork or low. They have one other to accommodate them. And my sole goal was just to have another hunter and my family to carry on my name. So I was just sitting there laying on the grass. I'm like, Lord, if you get me through this, I will have the child. Because the only reason I don't believe in abortion, but the doctors made me abort the first one because of the medication I was on. And so I was like, if she ever gets pregnant again, that will never happen again. So when I found out, this was actually amazing. And they tried to make us... They tried to make me abort again. They kicked me off my trial, and I said, because I took her down to the clinic, I said, they're going to kick me off the meds. I don't know what to do. And then I said, I took her off the table, went to the back, kicked her off the table, said, you know what, they're going to kick me off. I'll die for my son or whatever. And then, so he was born, so I was happy.
Okay.
Best feeling ever.
Testimony.
But we're sitting here talking about kisses and hugs, and we're talking about people being
in love.
Thank you. Kick it love. To me.
To Miss Akilah
so,
Chene.
As I told you at the top of the show, we're going to have a special artist spotlight today. This one is extra special because this is my cousin, and she's ultra, ultra talented. Her name is Ash Rogue, and I'm just going to read a little bit about her. We're going to listen to her song, and she's actually, hopefully she's listening right now. She's going to call in and just share a little information with us. Ash Rogue is a testament to an uncommon divinity in hip-hop culture. Producer, songwriter, musician, A. Rogue has performed at countless locations in the Philadelphia tri-state area, including the Trocadero, Dover Downs Casino, and the Clef Club, in conjunction with her band, Out the Basement. I want to make sure I tell the story of the other woman in the room, the cool wallflower standing beside the cover girl. A. Rogue was born in Flint, Michigan on December 6th. The song that we are getting ready to listen to is called Who Am I? And it's a crucial remix. This was requested by my Auntie Brenda, her mother, which I hope you're listening to. Shout out to you and everybody else. Listen to it, and I hope you enjoy.
DJ Reed, cue us up. Chris.
DJ Reed.
Such a habit.
When I was a little girl, my mama taught me many things. Sales to different cities, Mercedes, Benz, and living the hugs of a dream.
But nightmares that always sing. Clubs around like yo-yo string. Winding around our throats like trees to rope that's hanging by a damn crook string. Hey, I pull no risk call please. But the poppy lines mighty black to me. And if the light is shining on the humble G, I'm down and wonder what happened to me. To us, had the best of luck and good intentions when we move. Mind running from a deadbeat dad move west to find a reason's new attitude. A do-right woman on a mission. Tons of ambition. That nigga stripping, pimping. Hit the coach, class middle fingers flipping. Moved to Kelly and became nomad. SoCal broke now, no dad fix that. Pack the thumb, yet the moon to the owl. Henryville, Richmond, Sam Pop. As we were drowning in debt, saw firsthand how money can make mice some men. Scrambling for cheese, weary of cats and ties with pens. Luckily one bitch survived to even out the playing field. Ask why? And you ask who am I?
You ask who am I?
And you ask who am I? I'm that cool and collector mover. Smooth by the ride, refined by the ruler. A hard hit six, but life for two. But these hard knock lessons won't boot a loser. It's a bed that I want the best. And I want it so bad, my drop will not rest. See, I had enough bed, time to put it to bed. So I bang bad beats of Jack Jones with pens. Who the thunk? Woody's in the running. Know the game great, getting cosmic money. Front it, they told me that I had to be a savage in this game. But I got MOBs in my honey. Never let, never lie. I'm all number one, living by till I die. Been quick, fast, speed, come against me, cause I'm a real tip. I never slow down. Think I'm gonna need a towel for these hoes, bloody mouths, bloody nose, from these damn bloody blouse. I beat the beat up basically, and with a fistful of mic, I squeeze painfully. From a small girl to a bad bitch, with big dreams, duck down, show down. No, now. And you ask who am I? And you ask who am I? Now who am I?
And we are back, and we have Miss Ash Roke on the line. How you doing, girl?
You know, listen.
How are you this evening?
I'm good. I'm good.
Okay,
cool.
Go ahead.
I'm doing good.
Okay,
no, no,
this is what I need you to do. I need you to tell us about the song, inspiration, meaning, and then I'll have another request for you.
Okay, sounds good.
Oh yeah, and turn down your radio or your computer or your phone, whatever it is.
Sorry, I just turned it down.
Okay.
On you.
Ash?
Yeah. She went rogue on us.
Oh, she went rogue on us.
I did.
Tell us about the song.
Well, the song is actually kind of just about my story kind of coming up, you know, trying to show a different side to what most people think a female rapper is. Everybody has a backstory, but you don't ever really get to see it or hear it, should I say. So I'm just trying to show, like, that everybody's journey is a little different to becoming the artist that they are.
Indeed.
And just trying to make sure that it doesn't look so one-sided. You know, I try to present a different side to what is expected and what can be.
So when, because I was having a nice deep conversation before I even came to the studio, but if you were to put yourself in a category, I guess, for female rappers, like how would you classify yourself?
Honestly, I wouldn't even call myself a female rapper. I think I just call myself a rapper, period. I think a lot of people get, like, typecast when they start saying they're female rappers. They expect certain things of them. So if I had to put myself in any category, I guess I'd be a little bit more on the conscious side, but I definitely have a bit of a bite to the way that I deliver my rhymes, so, yeah.
Okay. Well, my last question statement is, where can people find you, your music, social media, all of that?
SoundCloud, definitely. SoundCloud has a ton of material on there, more to come soon. You just look up MIZROGUE. I'm on Facebook under Ash Rogue. I'm on Twitter as Ms. Rogue, same spelling. Instagram, same thing. Yeah, you could check out my work anytime, or you could go to ashrogue.com where you can contact me via email, check out my bio, and any new uploads that I have will definitely be posted there as well. one more thing is the band Out the Basement. You can check us out too at outthebasement.com.
All right. Well, I thank you for staying up late and tuning in, because I know that you are in Philly and it's late over there. It's late here, so it's later there. So shout out. Love you much. Hopefully I can see you soon.
Especially in Philly.
Yes. Yeah. Love you too.
Did you go to the Welcome Home concert?
I did not. I did not.
Did you see it though? Did you see it?
Hello?
Did you see it?
No, I didn't see it.
Oh, okay. I heard it was
rocking. I wish I could have.
It was rocking.
Only you.
Let's. It was rocking.
Are you going to end the conversation? I was ending it, and you asked the question, so you end the conversation.
Oh, well, you know, I end conversations a little differently with women. But, you know, I don't even want to get in trouble. It was nice meeting you, little lady, listening in.
Little lady.
Miss Ash Rogue, thank you for calling in, and stay with us.
Oh, yeah, thank you.
For sure.
All right. Now, we're going to get into some more good stuff. Finance. So we talked about fatherhood. We're transitioning real quick to finance. So I'm going to share again some information with you guys, and then we're going to chat about it. So this article is called The Black Male Hustle. This is really quick information I want to give. It's by Kenneth Braswell. Couple of things. He said every man had a way of making money when legitimate employment wasn't available. There was a guy who sold dresses in the trunk of his car. Before lottery offered the opportunity of a dollar and a dream, there was a local dude you could play numbers with who had the ability to keep hundreds of numbers in his head without ever writing them down. Hustling was a part of the normal landscape of my Brooklyn life. What you know about that, Nails?
I know. I know about that.
He said among high school dropouts, black male unemployment is over 50%. African Americans created businesses. This is just some information maybe that people didn't know, that African Americans created businesses at 3 times the rate of others in this country, and that there are over 110,000 black millionaires in America. He suggests that there is more to learn from those who are doing right than those who are doing it wrong, because we know, again, black men get the stereotype of they're just hustlers, they're just drug dealers, they, you know, this, that, and the other, which we know that some are. But again, I wanted to highlight kind of more of the positives. He also says people choose to do what is right for his or her needs at the moment without ever considering its long-term implications or consequences. That is a reality in every hood I know, because right isn't an available option. So he says, as we labor through the challenge of waiting for the economy to improve for black men and those in poverty, new and innovative ways of cultivating and structuralizing the fierce ingenuity of entrepreneurship for these men must be developed. There's a couple of more things that I'm going to share before I kind of get into some of your commentary, Kelvin. But I know that one of the things that you have done as a young African-American male is created a business for yourself. And so I'm going to want you to chime in on that. But I just want to give this real quick. These are financial death traps. These are 10 easy ways for a black man to go broke. This is by Dr. Boyce Watkins, who is a black man, an educator, and a finance professor. Number one, he says, having too many kids out of wedlock. An excessive number of baby mamas is one of the fastest ways to lose all of your money and have it constantly being sucked out of you like a high-powered vacuum cleaner. he said pulling at the side of your neck. I got a visual. Just to run through it. Number two, not getting a good education. Walking away from education is the biggest mistake many black men can make in America. When you walk away from education, you are walking right towards slavery. Number three, not learning a professional skill that makes you employable. Getting an education is not the same as having true skill and experience. He basically was talking about, just to kind of sum up this little part, that sometimes people go into life just having this one plan. They put all the eggs in one basket. I'm going to be a star athlete. I'm going to be an NFL player. I'm going to do this. And then when it doesn't work out, they don't have the necessary skills needed in order to go into the workforce, because they spent the majority of their time focused on hooping outside or you know, writing rhymes. Number four, trying to impress random women. Impressing the right woman can be profitable. Impressing every pretty girl you meet can leave your pockets empty. Save your financial swag for a decent woman you respect, not the next Evelyn Lozada you meet at the club. Number five, getting caught up in the liquor, weed, culture, or any other form of costly addiction. Whether it's drugs, alcohol, or gambling, addictions are a very easy way to empty your bank account. He goes into a little talk about Allen Iverson, and if you know his story, then you kind of know where that's going. Number six, being overly materialistic. Always needing name brand clothes, fancy cars, and other status symbols can put unnecessary pressure on you to impress people who don't even matter. Mm-hmm. To be honest, most billionaires I know wear regular clothes and drive cars that cost less than $30,000. I'm not joking. Most of the self-made billionaires' energy is focused on the internal things that make them feel good and the decisions that need to be made for them to make their next billion. Number seven, always working for the white man, or really any man for that matter. Black males have the highest rate of unemployment of all groups in the United States. This is mainly because white people do not want to hire us. He was at the top of his class in college. He had a triple major with a 3.9 GPA. He was the only African American in the world to earn a PhD in finance in the year 2002. But still, within working in corporate America, he still felt psychological pressure because they wanted him to conform into something that he wasn't, and they were trying to push him out of the workforce. So what he did was he started his own business. One of the things he says is, if you want to make money without suffering the psychological damage that comes from severe and consistent emasculation, I encourage you to A, start your own business, or B, at least have side streams of income. Number eight, getting caught up in the criminal justice system. Let's be clear, black men are considered food for the criminal justice system, the same way a whale feeds itself on small fish. The prison industrial complex is a multi-billion dollar industry, and there are billions more earned when you enter through the judicial system. As Malcolm X once said, the white man will sell you the liquor bottle so he can lock you up for being drunk. So you know all the music on the radio encouraging young black men to get high and drunk, carry guns, sling dope, and shoot each other in the street. Many of the same companies that produce this music have also invested in private prisons. Number nine, choosing the wrong person to marry. I've seen men lose everything in divorce. I've seen men marry women that they can't afford. I've seen men brought into situations where they were expected to be the financial savior of the entire extended family, dealing with intense pressure from a pile of financial parasites who see them as a chance to live a better life. The best path is to choose a woman who is an asset to your financial situation, not a liability. And finally, number 10, not working hard every day and setting goals for your life. Laziness is a disease. The worst thing to hear when you ask a young brother what he's doing with his time are the words, nothing, chilling. Laziness keeps a man from being a man and going out to get what he wants. Don't let anyone make you feel bad about grinding day and night for your dream. Last thing by Malcolm X, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today.
Amen, Brother Mal.
All right.
Thoughts. So I know that was a lot, but I want to get it all out so then we can kind of talk about it.
Yeah, he touched on some key stuff. One of the things that jumped out to me immediately was having multiple streams of income, multiple hustles, if you will. A lot of, we can't put all of our eggs in one basket. We gotta have something diverse in order for us to make it. So I don't care if it's $10 a week. That $10 a week over time will always do something. When I was young, I started my first business. It was like 11 years old. I had a lawn service. You know, I cut all the lawns in the world, and I still use the phrase I used then, which is, if you can grow it, I can cut it. That's before I moved into the barbering industry. However, one of my mentors told me that real wealth is not measured by money. Real wealth is measured by time. So it's not about how much money or how much assets you have right now, because depending on who you are, you can spend it quickly.
Right.
But real wealth is measured, you know, by time. Like, how long can you survive with nothing else coming in? And so if I want to be able to survive at least, you know, a couple years, you know, by a couple, I mean 20, 30 years just off what I have. You know what I mean? So, yeah, we got to get it together. Brother Malcolm had it right. You
know, brother Malcolm.
Good brother Malcolm.
Okay, you were being modest over there. I need you to tell us about your businesses.
All right. In 1996, I started the lawn service, you know. 2004, I started my first corporation, which is In The Zone Incorporation. We have barbershop storefronts. So that was in college back in 04.
I remember.
And then from that, we have, through In The Zone, we have the In The Zone music group, In The Zone production, and then we also have the interior design business that are all under that corporation. So in that, I think we're going to talk about it tonight, is the legendary My First Fridays show. And that was built on out of the barbershop. You know, the barbershop culture has always been a staple in the Black community, and we using the platform that we had to bring people together. 2009, I have started the Living Room, which is our nonprofit, our ministry, and currently, you know, doing the clothing line at SLC Los Angeles. But it's all about, man, just having a passion for what you do. I don't think it sounds like a lot, but I think I do the same thing over and over again. I just serve people, and I try to monetize that effort. You know, I don't want my, you know, when you wake up, like, wealth is measured by time. So we got to get paid for our time. Anything that you're doing that you are not getting paid for, it's a hobby. It's not a business. A lot of, you know, I love Black people, but I do not like when we say we're in business and we ain't making no money. That's not business. You just like to sew. You know what I mean? You just like, that's a hobby, you know. It's a business when we are making a profit, and that profit, it can be something that we share and that we leave. We leave for our kids. So a lot of people call me old, like, oh, Kel, you act like an old man. But
you do.
I take that as a compliment, because these old men got it together, man. And it's time for us young people, you know, to really advance into some new financial habits, to set an example for the next generation to come. So I don't want to talk too much, but I do got some stuff to say about savings.
Go ahead.
Keep talking.
All right. So real wealth is measured by time. Mm-hmm. If we're not putting anything away, we have to acknowledge the fact that we're going to die. You know what I mean? I guarantee you, if you calling in tonight to 323 whatever, you know, the first thing we should say when you pick up the phone is, hey, you're going to die, you know. And a good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children, you know. And where's our inheritance? You know, the Bible says, you know, that you can find where a man's heart is, but where his treasure is. And how can we say we love our women, we love our kids, and our treasure is in our cars? You know what I'm saying? Like, we're driving our blessing around. We're driving our legacy around. Or we're wearing our kids' future. Or we're eating it up. These restaurants got money. They don't need no more of ours. You know, we got to empower ourselves. Even if it's a year of eating at the house, you'll save so much money and leave yourself a legacy. So I'm big on that. I'm actually coming from a class right now, you know, where I'm trying to expand my mind and the thoughts of my family concerning savings, concerning insurance. Black people, get insurance.
Yes, please.
I just bought it from
myself. I wish I was still licensed, because I'd be like, you can hit me up and I can get you some.
Yo, you know what I mean? We got to get that together. You know what I mean? Outside of car insurance, you know, they make you have it for a reason,
right?
You know, but life insurance, renter's insurance. If you live in an apartment, get renter's insurance. We're talking about two cups of coffee, you know what I mean? The premiums, maybe $12, $15 a month. But this is information that we just don't share, because it's assumed that I don't give nobody props for wearing Jordans, because Michael Jordan Corporation has money. If you shopping at Nordstrom's has money. I want to know that if and when you die, how is your family going to be taken care of? And that's the conversation that we need to start. So I celebrate this platform to come here on on your radio show and talk about the things that are relevant to our culture. But please, 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 save as we diversify. I know we want to ball out now. I've been guilty of it. I struggle with an addiction to German cars. Oh my goodness. Mercedes, BMWs. Like, it was a good 7 years I was addicted to them G things, man. And yo, as I say, I'm delivered. It just don't make any sense at the end of the day. You know, you're spending so much money and only people on the outside of the car can really appreciate the rims that are on it.
You're right.
You know,
that's what I tell people when my car is dirty. I can't see it.
I can't see it. Yeah, yeah. So,
because the inside's clean.
That's right.
Yeah, keep right. It clean. Yeah.
I do. My car is clean right now. But you know, it's funny that you mentioned that because I was watching an interview with Dame Dash on the Breakfast Club with DJ Envy and Charlamagne.
Yeah.
And one of the things that he was like really stressing is like, you know, you gotta be your own boss. And you know, if you're a man not working for somebody else. But his main thing was really, you know, telling DJ Envy, like, you know, how are you going to be able to, you know, take care of your kids? Do you have the ability that if you don't want to go into work tomorrow to just be like, all right, I'm not going into work tomorrow? Like, can you make your own decisions? Can somebody fire you, you know, and stop your income? And that was kind of the message that I kind of took, like just being able to sow into your own dreams and then making sure that you provide a stream of income that you control, in a sense, yeah. That someone else can't just come one day and just be like, all right, nah, I don't really like you anymore. Like, you're done.
Yeah, I agree with that to an extent. But I also strongly disagree with the being your own boss. If I can get paid and get somebody else to fund my kid's future,
right?
I feel like you're winning. So it's no, I salute all these brothers and sisters out there that's working for a major corporation or what have it. But it's our responsibility. Once we cash those checks, where that money goes, we got to command our dollars to go perform for us. We got to tell them exactly where to go. So, you know, shout out to Dame Dash for his opinions. However, you know, there's a lot of people in the working community that are cashing checks, that are not their own boss. But you make yourself your own boss when you appropriate your funds for your family's future, you know.
Right, and I'm glad that you said that because as I was watching it, it was a lot that I was obviously disagreeing with him with, but that just one little piece I was taking like, okay, making sure that you sow into yourself because, I mean, there are certain careers that obviously you're going to need to have somebody else over you work with. I'm a teacher, so I wouldn't have it any other way. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not ready to open up my own school and do all that. Sometimes, you know, you're not ready to go that far. But I just thought that that was interesting and how he just kept, he was like poking. I don't know if you guys saw it, but.
Yeah, I heard a little bit about No, I didn't see it, but I heard a little bit about it.
And Charlamagne's had that conversation more than once.
Oh, has he?
Yeah.
I seen it. It was a pretty dope interview. It was really, really, really informational as far as the Breakfast Club, the same interview. But I think as far as what he's trying to get across as far as excitement, I would say investing in your own dreams or whatnot. When you're saying about, like, if you were able to not go to work, can your kids still have whatever they need or whatever they want or whatever they desire if you didn't go to work? Sometimes if you call off work, well, you can't pay the bills or whatever, but if you're instilling your dreams and being your own boss, if I don't go to work, me not going to work is not gonna take away from my daily life. That's the main thing. Like, if you stop going to work, can you still provide, can you still live day to day without them having to write you a check? Can you write your own check? Can you make your own rules? And that's the main thing that you wanna do when you're following dreams. Like, me being in California right now, that's part of my dream, so. I mean, I just fulfilled it, but, and y'all doing this right now, so it's like, I mean, you just really invest in whatever you want to go for, whatever you want to do, you have to make that sacrifice to go ahead and do it, and don't look back, don't take any second chances, don't put it all out there, put your life on the line. That's mainly what I got from the interview when you were speaking on that main little piece, but other things, like you were saying, I didn't really agree with or really, like,
would say, relationship with or like relate to. Mm-hmm. But that piece right there, that's like something I really live by. Like, I don't take no for an answer, and you got to go all out. Big profits come with big sacrifices.
That's right.
Fortune favors the bold.
Calvin.
Yes, ma'am.
What was it that inspired you to start First Fridays?
Keys 77, right?
Yeah.
I'm from the business standpoint, I always look to a niche market, you know what I mean? And to be very practical about it, I opened up a business. I had a barbershop and I had one employee and I was trying to finish my degree. So we're upside down. I kept pulling money from my savings to fund the business. And like I said earlier, the business was a hobby. So I had to figure out something, you know, to do. And I play a little bit of bass, and I was planning, you know, playing for the starters. I was playing, yeah, that was a high five in the studio, if you're not watching.
Bass player.
Yeah, so I was playing for this artist, and we would have rehearsals at the barbershop. And, you know, I was just talking to him, really good friend of mine, Jamal. He's actually DJ Malski. You know, we hear him all over LA. But this is going back about 11 years. Mm-hmm. So we're just having a conversation as friends, and he was like, man, let's invite people in for the show. You know, we invited people in for the show. It's about 12, 13 people. And then I start playing for Cal State LA's gospel choir and CSUN gospel choir. So we had this, you know, little network of people. We would like pull questions out the hat at my barbershop because I had to put the sweat equity in to my dream, you know. So it just became the Friday hangout spot. And then I realized, like, yo, what do I like to do? I like to flirt with chicks, be around fine women, and get money. But I don't want to compromise my faith to do so.
Mm-hmm.
Usually that platform was, you know, in the club, we turning up, whatever the case, you know. So it just was a sweet spot. Like, I bet there's other people out there like me that want to have fun, that don't want to be in church to have fun, that want to be around girls and girls be around guys, and it's a safe environment. So every First Friday, we would get together at the barbershop to do it. And that became, really, that was the third
the
employee.
Genesis.
You know, that's what made the business survive. You know, it wasn't haircuts at first. It was the First Friday, man. And man, it's been 11 years since we rocking
that.
So,
that's great.
You know, I got to keep it real with y'all. Other platforms, you know, it may sound so profound about the business structure and naming it the day of the. Nah, all of that is malarkey. Well, it was a need. I wanted somewhere to kick it, so I created it.
That's awesome.
And that's what's up. And I love First Friday. And I don't know. I think I was telling y'all that rap that I did the other day. I did that the first time.
She performed.
I did. I
performed
at First Friday
and turned it up. She did it.
And
I was turned up in here when she did it. I'm like,
they did this.
What?
And they were the first female artists that really, really rapped like that. You know what I mean? And they had. I mean, it was turned up. Everybody was in there like, say something else.
Yeah,
say
they
something
was.
Else.
What?
Say something else. Yeah, so people had fun, and in terms of living in LA, man, I got a lot of love for LA, but the subculture of LA doesn't really promote authentic people, man. And
you're right.
We have no culture in LA,
man. You gotta come to First Friday.
Yes, you have to come.
Tell them where you're from.
You always say that.
I went to First Friday, and I was like, we gotta come again. And then we didn't go again. I was so mad at Akilah Trinae, like, we need to go again. And then we went again, and I was like, okay, we gotta go every First Friday.
And I'm a bass player like you, so I'm always wanting to see it.
So it's more like a karaoke type feel, or is it like
karaoke? No,
I never been. So you got to know what I mean. So, you have to explain it to me. I never been.
So basically, it's a controlled open mic. You know what I mean? So
okay.
People come up. We screen everybody, and I do have a live band. Have the hottest band.
Yes, they
in
are
in the city.
They're
and that,
good.
And that actually parlayed into we call ourselves the Philosophers,
okay.
And basically it's like a brotherhood of about 30 to 40 musicians, and there's depth on every instrument.
Detroit, I'm telling you, if you went, you'd be like, oh my god, I'm gonna take out my bass and I'm gonna start playing for my shoes.
I wanna go. I've never been. I wanna go.
Oh, we have to go.
But it's anything that you hear is being played by a human being. You know what I mean?
Where is that? Where can be found?
Put the flyer back up again.
Man, put the flyer up.
Yes,
put the flyer.
You can follow us on social media at My First Fridays on every platform, Facebook and Instagram as well. Our venue is The Living Room over in Van Nuys, California. California, and the social media handle for that is at R12 Living Room. So the Living Room, man, it's where our culture, it's where we meet, it's where you live. It's an extension of your living room.
So it has that that intimate feel.
Intimate. Okay. Underground. You know, it's definitely a good look. If I die tomorrow, which people gonna die, right?
Right.
People gonna die. I'm very proud to leave that as a part of my legacy for the family. You know what I'm saying?
Just like speaking of death, I run into two people who work at Marchworth today.
Oh my god,
scaring the hell out of me. And now,
no, I'm just saying.
Oh,
we talk about money, we got to talk about death, because most people go broke trying to bury folks, man.
I mean,
they do.
You know, when black people die, we have a car wash. When people who plan funny. When they plan, it's not that sad.
We had an hour long conversation about that today.
Yes.
And it's just weird because my cousin, he's in the business. So when I saw him on the street, I'm like, hey, oh man, yo, you probably here because somebody, well, you know, go do what you got to do, bro.
Yeah.
See you later.
Yeah. And it's a business for a reason.
It is.
It's a business for a reason. You know,
I grew up in it. I can't.
So the financial piece, I don't know how we're doing on time, but
I want to talk about the faith piece.
Have a plan. Those are the three words I'll leave you with in terms of finances. Have a plan. Have a plan. Rainy day, have a plan. For wealth building, have a plan. For college, have a plan. And, you know, I ain't the Grim Reaper, but you're going to die.
You're going to die. You're so, going to die twice if you're a Gemini.
So have a plan.
I'm just kidding.
Chris
that
Rock.
Was yeah. Chris Rock.
That was special.
Well, since we got the morbid part out of the way, let's be happy. We ain't closer than Dove, DJ.
What?
C Slim.
What are you
DJ
saying?
DJ C Slim.
Articulate.
What are you talking about?
DJ C Slim.
I told you we're going to die.
Cue us up. This is music. Love. Yeah.
Got to tell you, but I'm afraid I don't know how. 'Cause there's a possibility that you look at me differently, love. Ever since the first moment I spoke your name, from then on I knew that by you being in my life, things were destined to change. 'Cause love, so many people use your name in vain. Love, those who have faith in you sometimes go astray. The ups and downs, the joys and hurts, love, for better or worse, I still will choose you first. Oh, 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 oh. Many days I've longed for you, wanting you, hoping for the chance to get to know you, longing for your kiss,
for your kiss, touch, for your
feel,
for
your presence. Many nights I've cried from the things you do, felt like I could die from the thought of losing you. I know that you're real, with no doubts and no fears and no questions.
Yeah.
Throw on the
song, Miss D.
You better sing D-Lo.
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 D-Lo, hit that note.
Dolores, Lola, D-Lo.
All the names. All the names. All right. Last segment is Faith. And
Faith.
I really just more so had a question. It's kind of like for, I guess, the panel and specifically you. But I wanted to know, personally, for the young men on the panel, if there's anything or one specific thing that you feel like you have had to struggle with the most and how your faith has played a role within that struggle.
Man, that is a loaded question.
It is. I know.
If I had to simplify it, I would say identity. Struggle with my identity as a man, my identity as a black man, my identity as a father, et cetera, et cetera. And my faith, it literally is the only thing that I have to bank on. I had a great father, you know, have a great father, and but I can't be him. My path is different. My sons are different. My wife is different. My circumstances are different. So having that foundation is one thing, but looking towards the future, I can only rely on faith. As a kid, when I grew up, you know, my parents were married, you know, 35 years, and they would tease us about, like, you guys are perfect. We lived in the hood, but we were homeowners, mm-hmm, you know what I mean?
Right.
So it's like, yo, yeah, we live here too, but we're homeowners, right? You know, people would tease us, like, because we had rules, you know? So I struggled, man, because I wanted to be, you know, you know, gang banging and doing all that stuff. I got in a lot of fights as a kid because I had parents. They thought I was, you know, my friends would say I was a square because I had to be home. Like, man, you know, and then I figured it out. Like,
don't, first name's Clarence.
Yeah, don't hate on me because, you know, because my parents love me. And in the confused kid's mind, I'm thinking, you know, my friends that live in apartments, they got a swimming pool and we don't. Mm-hmm. You know, so that struggle, it was real, and I just feel like my faith in God, man, has really just anchored me in terms of who I am, what I'm supposed to do. It anchors me in where I'm going. You know, it's the one thing that I do have confidence in, because the economy changes, you know, relationships change, friendships change, but you know, my faith in God has been the one consistent thing in my life that I know when I pray, God is listening to me. He's faithful. He's just, I know that God's ways are not my ways. Mm-hmm. And that's encouraging to me. You know what I'm saying? And
go ahead.
You know, that identity struggle has been, you know, something that's really made me rely on God. And then once you start getting money, yo, you start wanting to be, for me, I'm like, man, I feel like I gotta talk a certain way. That's an identity crisis.
Right.
You can't get into meetings and start having some money and call money paper. Like,
right.
Like, yo, let's get this paper. You know, there's other motivators like capital campaign. You know, and in the black church, we want the building fund. You
right.
know, in the white church, we said we're doing a capital campaign and some project giving. It's the same thing. We need right. y'all to give some bread mm-hmm. to get this thing done. But you start changing the vernacular, and you kind of lose a bit of yourself. But faith in God just, you know, has really helped throughout that. So. That's thanks for asking that. That's
what's up.
Crazy. I should have wrote my answer down, right?
But no, that was great. That was, I mean, that was awesome. Yeah. Detroit?
I think, I'll put it like this. I think, for me, it's along the same lines when you say identity. But for me, as many conversations as I told you, with me, it's the conflicting part of being exposed to life late and knowing where I want to end up, and then the great fear of where we're going to end up. I just spoke about being dead, and that's my grandma, she was like Jesus' right hand man. Like, she thought she was Mary herself, and being exposed to life pretty much later, like the age of 20, when you get into the world, that's different. Well, for me, being raised up under her, well, I naturally want to be a preacher, you know, but my life doesn't say that I want to be a preacher, because I'm still trying to figure out who I am and where I fit and so many of these things are appealing to me, mm-hmm. you know, and it's like, well, how do you be a preacher and take interest in so many things? Am I wrong for that? And then it's, I can't be a preacher and still fear death, you know. But then, you know, my grandma said, you know, if you can think it into existence, you think God exists, you think you will live long, you will live long, you know. And sure enough, you know, I thought I was going to die. And up until the day that I got shot, I thought about death consciously. You know, I walked out, me and my cousin walked to school every day. One day I just chose not to go. My grandma said, eat breakfast. My cousin gets shot that day. You know, and then another day, I'm riding to school. I get jacked from my bike at gunpoint. You know, he said, I would kill you, but I don't have enough time to get away. You know, lets me go. You know, and then the day that before I get shot, I just happen to be walking back home. My brother acts like he's pulling up doing a drive-by on me. I hit the gate off vert, scared. I thought about death that whole day. And then the next 2 days after that, I ended up getting shot. You know, so it was like, it was just conscious. But then after that, and I'm like, okay, well, I don't fear death as much as I did before, but everything else is about me wanting to end up at being a preacher and knowing how many different things that I'm into or gravitate towards you. And especially with, you know how I talk, even with that, you know, like my grandma lived in the hood as well, but I never spoke how other people did. So I constantly was with that, you're better than me, but I've always wanted to fit in and be just, probably just fit in and be just like you. But mm-hmm. I don't talk the same way you do. And that's only because I just read a book, wrote essays, like I was just stuck up under my grandma, but I really want to be with you. But you know, since I'm casted out, you know, so now it's like, okay, where do I fit? I'm not a preacher yet. I don't even live that lifestyle, but that's largely why I gravitate to a church. That's why I got back in the church after I left the church. After I was church fatigued, it was hearing somebody preach, and it's like, well, if that's my end result, I got to get back. But then it's the between Sunday and Sunday trying to get that. I used to thought I had to be perfect, you know, but in recently talking to my uncle, is just do your best and try and be an effort and pray, get into your studies and whatnot. So that's largely my biggest, you know, to answer your question.
See Slim? Oh, you see Slim.
That's it.
Dark
yeah.
nail.
Well, what's the question?
Oh, no. Nah.
I didn't even get a question.
You're supposed to be ready. I said, as a young black male, or just as a male, period, what has been your own personal struggle, and how has your faith played a part in that?
Well, my personal struggle, I don't think any of you guys know, but I'm going to let it be known right now that I suffer from cerebral palsy. That played hell of a bit in my judgment calls, and even father, that's why I didn't have really too much to say in this show, because I'm just being a sponge right now listening to Kelvin, and just listen to what he has to say, because my faith in it was a bit of me being scared to be a father, because I know it's not genetic and I know it's not hereditary or anything like that, but it still happened, so it's always that chance. And I had a conversation with Dontrell last night, and I actually called my father, that's like my best friend, greatest man in the world. He just retired doing 32 years. My mom and him celebrating 36 years hey! Anniversary. So, you know what I mean? That's
35, 36, that's what's up.
So, and he was explaining to me some of the things that the way he kind of like, I wouldn't say enabled, but like just made sure I didn't have to go through the stage of letdown. But I just used that to trigger my ambition, as far as my dream was to make it to the NBA. I had scholarships and everything like that. Once they found out about my condition, the full rides turned into half scholarships, and I got left paying the bills and stuff like that. But I always made it a chance, or I always made it a thing to say that I can't make it to the NBA, but I still can make NBA money. That was my whole thing. So I just used that to turn around, and I've been through the most, you know what I mean? Hospitalized months at a time, couldn't grow, everything. I've been through it all. So I just used that that's my main thing, that was kind of psychological. Like, it bothers me or whatnot, but it's something I deal with on a day-to-day. But I just use that as ambition, light a fuel to my fire, but
That's my only thing. That's why I said I'm just being a sponge, because, like, that was my thing about being a father. Like, that I was scared of that. Like, even to this day, like, it's just, like, I want to, but, like, if something was to happen, I don't know how I react. I'd probably commit suicide. So I wouldn't, because I would think, like you said,
don't
like,
speak that.
It's my fault. Cause, I mean, we all going to die, right? No, I'm just saying, no.
Not at our own hands, though.
Right?
But, like, no, it's just the thoughts of that. It's just the thoughts of that or whatnot, but it definitely has been hard, because, like, I couldn't even, like, it was time I couldn't even walk. You know what I mean? Like, I remember waking up for school one day, I fell flat on my face. My mom had to teach me how to walk all over again. Wow. And stuff like that. So, like, I just, I mean, it was hard. It definitely takes us, like, it's totally different. It's a totally different thing. Like, you know what I mean? But, like, you wouldn't know.
Footnote, he's really good at basketball, too. You wouldn't know.
You wouldn't know. But that shouts out to my moms. Like, my mom's the greatest person to ever walk this place, like to ever walk Earth, besides
second the man to upstairs. Mine. No, I'm just playing.
No, like for real, like she just definitely. So yeah, it's just a definitely psychological issue that I have, and that's why I want to thank you for even coming, sharing your insight on everything.
All day.
And it definitely changed my outlook on a lot of things. But I mean, my father said it too, but just the person that I could relate to. And I mean, you walk like me, talk like me, when you don't talk like me. But you know what I'm saying? I mean, you're into the same things I'm into. And I mean, of course, my father's into what I'm into, but he got a different aspect of it, different vision on it. So for you to do so, it says it, like, I never had a big brother. So in the case of that, graduated, I got 2 degrees. I'm the only person in my family to graduate college. Basketball scholarship came, paid me with the school. So I'm doing all right, you know what I mean? So it's cool. It's cool. And
God is good.
It brought me here with y'all, so it's not gonna stop. But yeah, that's my thing. That's definitely something that's deep.
Well, yeah. I thank you, Darnell, for sharing. You know what I mean? Because it's not always easy to share or you know, share your testimony and what you've been through. And people don't know. You know what I mean? You don't know what somebody is going through, what somebody is dealing with. So, I guess my final words would just be to, you know, that's why you always need to be kind to people and show people love and just be kind of, Kelvin, what you were saying is just being able to support another person and meet their need wherever they may be, because I mean, next time it could be you. I know that's one of the things they always say at the church, like, next time it could be you. So you want to make sure you give as much as you can while you can, because you're going to have a turn, and you want people to be able to be right there as you were right there for them. But I know we're reaching the end of the hour, and I absolutely want to thank you, Kelvin. You're awesome. You're amazing. Very I learned awesome. A lot tonight just from you. You truly are an inspiration, and I want to give you an opportunity. Anything else that you want to share? I know that you have the Living Room on Saturday night, so maybe you want to tell people about that just in case they want to find themselves to worship there, and you know.
Well, thank you for that opportunity. Thank you so much for having me here. I was moved and touched by everything that that people shared. It's my baby girl's birthday, so I just want to say happy birthday. Aww. She should be
happy
should
birthday.
Be asleep. She turned 13, so happy birthday, Sanaya.
Happy birthday, Sanaya.
And just, you know, as always, any public platform I get, I want to honor my wife, you know. So shout out to Danielle. She probably sleep. My final words, man, it's nothing profound, but I want to address the single people out there, you know. And if you're single and you are interested in somebody, I just take this word of encouragement to be clear about what you want. You know, dudes, act like you like the women that you're interested in. And women, it's important to give a green light, you know, and make yourself available to be courted. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's my biggest passion in this life. I think people find a different fulfillment when they find that love that you know, God has had specially ordained for them. But we got to make a move in order to do that. So it don't have much to do with this topic, but it does undergird everything in life when you have that, when you have that person, you know. So it's a great time to be somebody's boo. So come out to the living room. it's a great time, man. Profound relationships with amazing people. 8 9s and dimes for the fellas, and you know what I mean. employed in shape. shape, men of God, for the ladies, man. That's what I'm praying for. Come out and check us out at the Living Room every Saturday night, 7:30. We would love to see you as well on April 3rd for my first Fridays. So, again, thank you for having me.
Oh, thank you for coming.
All right. Key 77.
Well, for Monday Night Love Sessions, this is Akilah, Trine, Kelvin. We got Dolores on the back. Key 77.
Woo-woo.
Nails. C Slim. This is great. Jigga. C Slim, take us out. Key, what's up?
Yeah. Show love without the expectation to get it back. That's real love. Let's stop pretending and let's get back to the real. Or let's all just die pretending we were real. ISO.
How could you judge me before you knew me and mean it truly? Talk to me rudely, I'm young and black, my life ain't a movie. But I stick to the script, I bring my lessons and gifts. I ain't stressing a bit, yeah, y'all on the edge of my dick. Hear about it and I'm the type to laugh. Y'all get frightened fast, shit to measure my movement. You need a seismograph. How could you not embrace your brothers and wanna help each other? It's like we wanna shine like lightning but scared to face the thunder. Maybe it's cause nobody had the perfect plans yet. Or maybe cause nobody heard them in the man yet. I bust it like cans of biscuits to make them grand stretch. Like Pillsbury, hear me niggas, your man's next. With or without y'all, my plans forever to represent. My mama told me not all will agree with your intent. And hence I see why they hating, it's Nathan, no offense. With me you clashing with titans, you more Toyota dense. See my ambition will distance me from my opposition. Us being one and the same, I'm in the opposition. I just stick to the real, I'm not in tune with the fake. I stay in tune with my fate, although they said I'd never be great. They said I'd never be, they said I'd never be. They said I'd never be great, great, great.
But then I'm lying.
But I can't be held till they can trace. I'm a witness racing. I won't go stop. See, I know okay. Face the hate, get no complaints. Get shot my dreams. I scope my trace.
But then I'm lying.
Because they said I'd never be great. Because they said I'd never be. They moving back with some fools eluding the foolish patterns. And now that 2012's over, they'll come with new disasters. It's due to Dapper, practice morals, that's truth to trappers. Stay on my hustle, processing numbers, Hewlett Packers. Some dudes are after the proof, sadly the truth is scattered. Some dudes combative, you challenge, they'll shoot the attatus. Ragged, rugged through our republic, we running like fuck it. Law and law be long on with the rules that can touch them. Bound by the bounds of bone and blood, the open consumption. Bound by the bounds of boxes blasting.